What's up, guys? It's your boy, Dwayne with Black Men Unfiltered. Hey, listen, go ahead and hit the subscribe button, hit the share button. Let's get this content rolling so I can get this content rolling. Go ahead and hit the subscribe button right now and hit the likes, keep the likes up. We're going to talk about something that today that's real near and dear, man, that a lot of people are in denial about. So let's get it. Be ready in just a second. So we're just gonna go ahead and jump right on in on this right here. What I want to talk about today on Black Men Unfiltered is something that a lot of people don't want to deal with. A lot of people don't want to talk about it. A lot of people are in denial about it. A lot of people don't want to hurt other people's feelings about this in particular. And so I want to be able to bring some light to it and discuss it in a way that's going to be raw, in a way that's going to be unfiltered. There's no reason to have a show that says it's unfiltered when in actuality it's not really unfiltered. So let's be raw about the situation. And what I want to address is generational curses. Who raised you? And most of our families in the Black community, we talk about who raised us, who was influential in our lives, who was the positive person in our lives, the person that did the most for us, the person that gave us the most wisdom and the most knowledge. But can we go back and really, we talk about those things, but we never, ever, ever talk about who raised us and how they raised us in a way that was not the right way. See, generational curses, to me, my definition of generational curse is that you're carrying on with something. A tradition, a way you handle life, handle your family, handle your relationships, your husbands, your children, your wives. The generational curse simply means that you're doing something the way that someone prior to you done those things. But you have to ask yourself a question. Are those things really? Are those really the things that really you want in your life? No offense I hear to any mamas that raise their children, fathers that raise their children, aunties that raise their sisters' children, sisters who raise sisters' children, uncles who raise nephews' children. No shout out, no harm to you guys. But however, in order to solve a problem, you first must admit that you have it. And like most of us, we have suffered in this category. We have suffered tremendously in generational curses. Women cannot be the wives, proper wives, because of their mothers. Men cannot be proper husbands because of their fathers. Children that were raised in abusive homes, whether physical abuse, whether verbal abuse, whether any type of abuse necessary in the Black homes. So many comedians have made their living off talking about how their mom beat them and slapped them and choked them out and called them names and did them any type of way, right? But we have to go back, and I know, like I said, this video is going to probably make some people uncomfortable. even some people that are in my immediate circle, uncomfortable. But in order to solve a problem, you must first admit that you have one. And so, in that regard, the black community has that problem. We have a problem with generational curses. Well, we could start with the grandmothers and great grandmothers, with the PTSD of slavery passed down from generation to generation. I know a lot of you out there have grandparents that told you to act a certain way around white people. So they act a certain way around white people. How many times have you gone somewhere with your grandmother and your grandfather and they said, we're going in this store. We know the lines. Don't touch nothing. Don't ask for nothing. But most of all, don't go in here acting crazy in front of these white people. Generational curses that continue to pass down. This is one form of generational curses that I want to address. White, the white, we had to act a certain way in front of the white people. We had to be a certain way in front of the white people because our grandparents did not seek the mental help that they needed to get through what they went through. Great-grandparents, not grandparents. And so they passed that sickness down to us for us to understand, don't respect the white man. Don't challenge the white man. Watch your behavior in front of the white man. Don't be you in front of the white man. Save that for when you get to the house. This is what we were taught. And that passes down as a generational curse. Now, so many people, myself, I'm one of those guys that would consider myself woke. I'm one of those guys that consider myself, I'll challenge anybody. That no white man's going to just sit up and tell me anything and I don't challenge him, right? I make my own decisions. I walk into a store, I'm going to be me in spite of what grandmother and grandfather may have said back in the day. Because I realize that I'm my own man and nobody's going to tell me anything. You're not going to tell me what to do, how to do it. You're not going to tell me anything. I run at my own speed. Yes, can we have a conversation, a respectful conversation? Yes, but I'm not going to reinvent myself to respect the white man. That was something that was passed down from great-grandmother, great-grandfather, grandfather, grandmother. Respect the white man. No matter what he does to you, no matter what he says to you, you shut your mouth and you move on. But that's not the world we live in anymore. Now, some kids that I grew up with are still that way. There's a white man. Don't say nothing. Don't challenge him. Don't you say nothing. That needs to end. Be yourself in spite of who you're in front of. Caucasians, African Americans, Cubans. It doesn't matter. Right? You need to be yourself. You have to be yourself. That's one area of a generational curse. The second one is that we as a black community, I've been guilty of this as well, when our kids speak a dream, we seem to take the dream and kill it immediately. Black parents, we talk about the oppressor, which the oppressor is real. You know, I know, I'm a huge advocate of knowing who the oppressor is. But sometimes I'm almost gonna say us because I'm guilty of this as well. Transparency is good for the soul. We are dream killers. Parents, we are dream killers. Our parents were dream killers. Let me ask this question. How many times have you gone to your parents, people my age, how many times have you gone to your parents when you were a child and said, I want to be a doctor? And your mom, your dad, your aunt, your grandmama, your granddaddy said, who going to pay for that? Boy, you better find you something that school can pay for. I want to be an engineer. Who finna pay for that? That's crazy. They're hiring at the mill. How many dreams have been averted because parents have been dream killers? Right? Because they weren't able to do it. They know that their great-grandmother wasn't able to be successful. The grandparents weren't able to be successful. Now your mom and your dad are telling you the same thing their grandmother and grandfather, your grandmother and grandfather told them growing up. What? engineer, doctor. But our Caucasian counterparts, oh, wow. Let's start investing in books and let's start putting him around. Let's do an internship when she's 16 or he's 16 with a nurse and a doctor so he can get the feel of what it's going to be like in day-to-day movements. We're dream killers. Second form of generational curses. Who raised you? Who raised you? It's tough. This is a tough conversation to have. Right now, parents out there right now still being dream killers. Their child wants to go and pursue a dream. No matter what it is, they tell you what the dream is. I think that parents should jump right in on it. We're all guilty of it. I am too. But we should all jump in and say, how can we invest in your dream? Is this something you really want to do? Have them commit to what it is that they really want to do, and then invest in your child. No matter what it takes, invest in that child, and then that child's dream, we can make that. You can make your child's dream come true. We're all guilty of it. We all have room to be better. But another thing is that we can look at here from a cultural standpoint is that can't nobody tell us nothing, right? So I can sit here all day till I'm blue in the face and thin in the waist and tell you guys, hey, listen, you're dream killers. But there's going to be some people set in their ways, some grandparents still raising children set in their ways and going to say, I don't care a damn what you say. Who going to pay for that? Who going to do that? And when you set in your ways like that, there's no help for you. People can talk to their blue in the face, but there will be no help for you because you refuse to listen. You refuse to make the necessary adjustments in your mind, the necessary adjustments in your heart to do the right thing. So let's stay with parenting for a while, right? Let's start with fathers, because I don't want the women to think I'm going to attack them and let them go first. We're going to talk about both. Let's start with the fathers. There's a lot of women out here that accuse men of being trash. They accuse men of not being, they accuse men of being deadbeat fathers. They accuse men of being deadbeat husbands. They accuse men of being abusive mentally, physically, verbally, sexually, on and on and on, right? But are we really want to talk about the generational curses that men had to deal with? How many of you had uncles growing up where your uncle said, if you don't have sex with this certain amount of women, you ain't nothing. You ain't shit. How many of you have had a cousin that you grew up with that says, oh, I want you to go have sex with this woman? How many men out here were molested by adult women? How many men out here were molested by adult males when they were children? Because see, one of those things that we can add to this whole parenting thing is back in the day, the black people had a saying, well, go on in my house, stay in my house. So there was no outside help to help you if you are a male being abused by your uncle. You are a male being forced into sexual acts, whether male or female. Males that were pushed into sexual things by people they're supposed to love and trust. I was listening to an episode of Ayala because I try to stay well-rounded and I listen to the things that sometimes I agree, sometimes I don't agree. But there was an episode of Ayala where it wasn't an episode. She was at a concert or she was at some award ceremony. And that's when everything with R. Kelly just broke loose. And she said, they asked her, how do you feel about R. Kelly and everything that he's doing with the ladies? She said, well, what I'm going to say to you is not going to be sexy. She said, being in the world of counseling and mentoring and being in the world of being a person that helps people with their mental discrepancies, she said, what she's learned, and it's a clinical fact, that in some people, which is severe, people, she said, in R. Kelly's case, she said, people stay in their minds their bodies grow, but they stay at the age, if they don't get any help, they stay at the age that the trauma happens. We're talking about R. Kelly going to jail up to 30 years and racketeering and all this other stuff, but watch, listen to this. R. Kelly was raped by his uncles. He was raped by his aunts. Right? This is a fact. Right? When he was probably 11, 12 years old. It got to the point R. Kelly made a video about him being in love with his mom. At that age, his mom used to drink out of a coffee cup, and he'd go over and her lipstick would be on the coffee cup, and he'd start kissing the coffee cup because the house was dysfunctional. He was putting sexual behaviors that were not of him. And so his mind stayed where the trauma happened, according to Ayanna's beliefs and her studies and her skill set. And she said, well, he never got help for that. So if R. Kelly is guilty of all these things with these females, not justifying anything. However, if Ayanna is telling the truth, this generational curse of, because I guarantee that uncle that raped him, that auntie that raped him, I guarantee that the same thing was done to them. So that generational curse passed down to R. Kelly. Can we imagine if Ayanna is telling the truth about your mind stays at the age that your trauma happened? That means R. Kelly, the girls that he supposedly had sex with or sexual acts with, were around the same age he was. The girls were the same age that he messed with when he was an adult. But we don't talk about those things. We want to throw everybody in jail. Everybody does not need to go to jail. Some people need to go to mental evaluation. Some people need to sit down with somebody and be healed from those things that have broken their families, that have broken family molds, right? There are some men out here that have had been having sex since they were 12 years old, 13, 10, 11, because a family member did it with them or put it on them to do that or peer pressured them into doing it because you're not a man unless you're getting some ass. That, if we're being honest, can I preach today? Touch your neighbor and say, we're dysfunctional, we're toxic. We have to admit that the things that we did, that the things that our parents taught us were trash. Not necessarily they were trash because they were taught the same thing. The whole methodology is trash. The things that they passed on us were trash, right? We sit and laugh, and I sit and laugh and talk with my brothers and my sisters, and we talk about how we got beat with extension cords, and how we got punched upside the head, how we got slid down the hallway, how we got talked to, how we got cussed out, and we laugh about it, and that is so toxic. I've had time to sit back and think about how toxic that truly is. It is so toxic. To sit and laugh about being abused. It's so toxic to sit and laugh about being punched in the head. Oh, I got punched in the mouth one time. My mama got mad at me. My daddy got mad at me. Punched me in the mouth. And then I had a bloody lip for a week. One time I got beat with an extension cord. Girl, went to school. I couldn't even sit down. How many of y'all know people that talk like that? That is so toxic. And how many people... That toxic stuff right there that we just got through talking about, how many of you exude that same behavior with your children? Men right now, we're not talking about the women. How many of you men have exhibited the same behavior and traditional behaviors with your children? I have. I'm admitting it to you. I have taken the same beating roles. I have taken the same roles of you need to beat your kids. Don't give it. You're caught. Your kids don't need to have a voice. They don't need to say nothing. They don't need to ask you nothing. What I say is law. You don't have a voice. Shut your ass up. Go in there, sit down, and be quiet. Go clean your damn room up. Don't say nothing to me. You don't have a voice. But daddy, but that. I shut your ass up before I knock your ass out. How many of us had parents that we grew up and they were like that? I'm guilty of it. How many of you guys are guilty of it? We have to be able to address these issues. The only way to address the issues is that you have to admit that you have the problem. You have to admit that I am a problem. You have to admit that I came from toxicity. You have to admit that I am a problem. I came from trash raising, trash traditions, trash, 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 trash. Why do we continue to live on in the trash? And right now, even to this day, I struggle with some things that I was taught when I was a kid. And then now I transfer it over to my kids, and my kids are like, Daddy. Same thing, we have to beat these generational curses. Every day we gotta get up, we gotta make a valid choice to say, damn. Right? I can be the first to admit, even recently, I did something so crazy, right? Right? You know how kids are being kids. You have to go back and look at yourself. When kids are being kids, when I did stuff and I snuck out the house and snuck out the window and came back home, got body slammed, you know? And so, because sneaking out and doing stuff, you know your parents gonna be worried about you, so they get so angry they beat the hell out of you, and then be like, oh, later on they put the Vaseline on the extension cord bruises, right? But I don't exhibit that severity of behavior. I have for a long time ago, but I don't exhibit that same behavior now. However, like making bad decisions and then having to go back and face your children that you say you love. And then the black people, they go back to, our culture goes back to the Bible. Spare the rod, spoil the child. The child will shame you. Yes, absolutely. Children need to be disciplined. Children need to be disciplined verbally, physically. They need to be disciplined. However, there has to be boundaries. We have to learn what boundaries look like. Right? Because you don't want to pass that toxicity down to your children, which is happening every day. Men. Absent fathers. Let's break it down. Absent fathers. One more time. Absent fathers are known as deadbeats. You ain't this. You ain't this. Women are out here dogging them. You ain't shit. You don't do nothing. You don't do nothing for your child. You do. But in the before you lay down with that man, that's another YouTube video for another day. But you have to understand the history of this man that you've laid down and conceived a child with. 50, 60, 70% of these men, I don't know the accurate number, I'm guessing. 50 to 70% of black men, I guarantee you, was raised in single parent homes with no male figure to show them how to be a man. They learn everything by watching mama iron skirts, mama cook food, mom teaching them the way of the woman, because no woman can teach a man how to be a man regardless of what anybody says. I don't care what culture we're in. I don't care about the gender roles. I don't care about people saying that women, a woman cannot teach a man or a boy how to be one. Just like a man cannot teach a girl how to be a woman. There needs to be, a man can show women things, but a woman needs to be able to go in and show her the nurturing side, how to love, how to be affectionate, how to be the anchor of a family, because knowing that her anchor is the thing that holds the family together. It's that thing that bonds the family together. But we'll get to that in a second. Fellas, let's stay on us for a second here. How many of us have been hoes out in the street having sex with every female that passed by? Why? We've been influenced. Our uncles, boy, you better go hit that thing, boy. Ooh, tear that thing up. Why you got in the coochie this year? Oh, man, you ain't no real man. You a punk. Can you imagine a 40-year-old man telling a 12-year-old boy that, and the 12-year-old boy looks up to that man? That man has influence over that boy. That boy becomes a hoe. He starts sticking everything. By the time he gets to you and gets you pregnant, he done had sex with 43 women. He really don't care, because his feelings about sex is basically just that. Sex. Right? And then you say you're a daddy now. He'd be like, okay, whatever. I ain't got to be in the child life. Why? Because if you look at his parenting, then his mom's probably a single mom. Like I said, 50 to 70% probably single black moms, no dad in the house. So shit, he say, I'm doing pretty good. I'm eating. I got a roof over my head. I ain't got to shit. Well, I ain't got to do nothing. I got a roof over my head. Everything's still working out for me. So my mama's single mama, single black woman. Right? My mama's single black mama, and so what is it that I got to worry about? Come on. And so he carries that on. If my mama did it, you can do it. I ain't got to take care of no kid. Huh? Deadbeat dad. Then y'all make up the thing, deadbeat dad. Well, what about help me dad? Help that dad. Because then he needs to sit down with somebody. right? He needs to sit down with somebody and come up with a situation and say, hey, I need help. But in the black community, are we really reaching out for help? Are we really reaching out for the help that we need? We're not. No black people, because guess what? Black people, again, the dysfunction and the toxicity is passed down from generation to generation. So if someone find out that Dwayne is going to see a counselor, a therapist, he crazy as hell. Good, leave him alone. Good, he going to therapy. You know, you're interested in a woman. Girl, I heard that nigga, he going to therapy. He crazy as hell. Don't talk to him. Am I lying to you guys? It makes no sense. So, moving forward, we talk about the deadbeat dads, right? We talk about men ain't shit. We talk about men ain't this. Men. But men were not raised by men. Men were raised by men and from the body aspect of it. But they were not raised by men from the mental aspect of it. I can look up and say my dad's 56, 70, 60, 49. But that little boy that didn't get any healing is still inside my dad. So now I'm talking. So me as a man that still has that 14-year-old boy inside of me, I'm talking to my dad who is 2 years older than me as far as maturity as a man. That means that I'm 14, he's 16. So basically mentally on the same level, mentally, me and him are on the same level as far as manhood, because he didn't get the necessary help when he was younger. So now he's 50, 60 years old and still has that thing on the inside of him that he didn't get help for. So if Ayanla is telling the truth about your mind stays where the trauma happened, your age and your mind stays where the trauma happened. So if my father had trauma with his father at 16, then his mind stayed at 16. He's 60 with a 16-year-old mindset about life, about sex, about women, about the situations that he's been in that traumatized him. So basically, me growing up with him, I didn't learn anything, right? So my morals are out the window, right? Didn't teach me anything about anything because his dad didn't teach him anything about anything. So then now you have an 18-year-old grandfather as a man because he wasn't raised to do anything but work, slave himself to death. He wasn't taught any morals, how to respect a woman. So you got an 18-year-old great-grandfather that's 100 years old, but he's 18 as far as his manhood. My father is 16 and I'm 14. So how can an 18, 16-year-old and a 14-year-old in our minds and where we're trapped, how can we be there for each other? How can that man be where he needs to be when he's stuck mentally? A lot of black men are in jail right now based off the fact of things that were passed down to them. My daddy was a jailbird. I'm a jailbird, right? My daddy had a lot of kids. I'm going to have a lot of kids. I don't have to take care of my kids. My dad didn't take care of no kids. Remember the Temptation song? My papa was a Rolling Stone. Wherever he laid his hat was his home. And when he died, he left everybody alone. We don't look at those things. We don't pay attention to those things. And we can sit up here and have, and that's what I want to be. I want to be real, because this is Black Men Unfiltered, all right? So y'all hit that subscribe button and hit the share button, all right? Let's get these likes up and subscribe to the page. But back to what I was saying, we don't talk about that, right? We don't talk about how the man is hurting on the inside. We don't talk about the little boy that's inside the man. We don't talk about that. We don't talk about the little boy that's screaming out for the attention. We don't talk about that. We talk about their deadbeats, they're cheaters, they ain't shit. Well, have you ever sat down and said, wait a minute, clinically, mentally, where is he? How about this for his birthday? How about this for, we're gonna go have a nice dinner at 5 o'clock when he gets off work, and then after that, we're gonna slide on over to a therapist and we're gonna begin therapy. We're going to begin therapy together. We're going to ease our way into therapy so we can understand what's going on in the mind. In the mind of this man that I love, that I've, or even in situations that I've once loved. A lot of women out there are married right now, hate their husband because of who their husbands are, who they became. But have you really sat down and tried to figure him out? Have you ever had to sit down and think about his childhood, the absence of his father, the trauma the age, the trauma happens is the age the mind stays until the help comes to release. So I am back. I want to get into basically to end with the men, right? To end with the fact that men have dealt with a lot, right? Men have gone through a lot. And am I making excuses for these men? Absolutely not. But these men need help. They need mental help. Mental health. It's okay to not be okay. And so we need to get the help that we need as men, right? To break generational curses. We can no longer be like daddy. We can no longer be like uncle. We can no longer force our sons into sexual behavior. We can no longer do that, because if we want productive men that's going to love a woman and be with a woman and marry a woman and be with that woman without cheating and being a hoe and being out in these streets, and our sons being for the streets, then we must be we must go get the help that we need. We must find therapy, right? There's no excuse right now. Most of your insurance and most of your jobs offer therapy as a free session, free 5 sessions. Take advantage of it. If you can afford to do it better financially, monetarily, then do that. But we need it. Us as men, we need it. So moving on, let's talk about our black women, which I think have gotten the real blunt. Ooh, I can't even, I don't even have words. See, what happens is this: women grow up with moms, but the generational curse with our black women, it starts at the top, right? It goes back to the story that I love to tell this story, right? There's this young lady. She's about 8 years old. And she went to her mom. And she asked her mom, "Mom, why do you cut both ends off of the ham before you put it into the oven and throw it in the trash?" The mom said, "I don't know. Go and ask your grandmother. I learned it from her." The grandmother so eloquently said, "I don't know. I learned it from my mother." Well, thankfully, 3 generations of the women are alive. So She said, go ask your great-grandmother, because we both learned it from her. The great-grandmother said, the little girl walked in and she said, great-grandma, I got a question for you. And the great-grandmother said, what is the question, baby? She said, I asked mama why she cut the ham. She told me both ends of the ham off. She told me she do it because grandma did it. Then I asked grandma. Grandma told me the same thing. She said she did it because you did it. And they both did it because you did it. The grandmother looked at the little girl and said, baby, I don't know why they do it, but the reason I did it is because the pan that I use was not big enough to hold the entire ham. So what that story is saying is that these women, the mother and the grandmother, have been following the traditions of mama for so long and not even knowing why they did it. Threw away tons of meat because of mama, because grandmama, because of great grandmama. But black women have learned that. Black women have gotten the short end of the stick because men are emotional as well. Some of them are, but women were created in that way, biblically formed in that way to be emotional. Women are emotional creatures. The Bible says, if I could use my preacher voice for a second, the Bible says that women are emotional creatures. So from conception, women that are going to be born are going to be highly emotional. So they take the brunt of the emotional dysfunction toxicity from birth, right? And can you imagine being a mother, a daughter, being brought up in a world where your mother's an alcoholic, your mother's at the club every weekend, your mother's smoking, your mother's drinking, your mother's having sex with multiple men. You're in the position to see these things. You see different men coming in and out the house. You see, catch your mom in sexual acts. You see your mom in sexual acts, right? But then don't we protect our moms, black women? Don't we say mama did the best she could? But did she really? Did mama really, really do the best she could? Did she really give you the tools for life? Or did we run into one of those things that make us bitter? Did we run into one of those things that the teaching that made us bitter? Is that what we ran into? That's what we ran into, ladies. We've learned from our moms from years and years, don't trust a man, don't be with a man, take a man for all he's worth, take a man's money, get you a man with a lot of money. And men ain't shit. Get what you can from him. Don't share anything with him. Don't share bank accounts with him. Keep your money to yourself. Even from a religious standpoint, we look at it as so most women are in religions and traditions that don't fit the lifestyle with their family. But instead of following the husband like she's supposed to follow the husband, because the Bible says there's God, God leads the husband leads the wife, and the wife leads the children. That is the foundation of religious, of Christianity beliefs. And so instead of following our husbands, women today, instead of following their husbands, they don't do it because mama said, this is the tradition that we follow. Mama said, this is the church we go to. Mama said, this is what we do as women. And so women today that are in their 30s and 40s and 50s still go by the traditions of their mom when they know it does not work. It's a part of them. It's like their arm. It's like their fingers. It's like their legs. It's like their feet. It's a part of who they are. And they refuse to change it. But women, like I said about the men, these women that who raised you? Generational curses. Who raised you? They raised you. I'm not saying your mom is trash, but her morals and her values, her decision making in front of you was trash. We brag about our moms fighting people. We brag about our moms beating us up. We brag about our moms teaching us stuff. But what did you really learn? What kind of woman are you today? What kind of woman have you become spiritually? Did your mother instill God into your life? Did she pour that God into you as a child? And then the thing that I don't understand, black women, we love you guys, but there's work to be done. One of the things I don't understand is that when you get older, you expect a man to lead you to Christ. You expect a man to be 100%. You expect a man to be perfect, but then you want a man to accept you for your imperfections. Your mama never gave you God, but you blame the man for not leading you to God. Your mama never instilled values in you, but you blame the man for not instilling values in you. Your mom never showed you what a leader looks like in your father because she chose to be with a man that was married, chose to be with a man that didn't want her, chose to be a shadow chick that only men slept with at night but never wanted to be seen with in the day. So she chose those type of relationships that you grew up in. Then you grow up in those same type of relationships. You grew up making those same decisions and those same choices. She never taught you moral value. She never taught you how to love a man, how to care for a man, how to be there for a man, how not to cuss him out, how to care for him and nurture him. When he's down, he's unemployed, you pick him up. When he's employed, you balance him. When he's hungry, you feed him. When your family is down, you pray for them. When there's things going wrong in the house, you are the anchor that holds the thing together. Women are fighting for rights. Women are fighting for leadership. Women are fighting for all these different things. But don't you know you were born with those leadership things? You were given, God has given you the orders and the job to be that, the anchor, the nourisher, the builder of your family. When your husband, it seems that the Bible says, I created woman to be man's help. So you are created to help the man. But so many women would disagree with that. I'm independent. I don't need no man. And the man I got, he can't be a part of my life, can't be a part of my money, can't be a part of my this, can't be a part of my that. I'm gonna put all these miles on my body. Women, self-care is the best care. As I said about the men being out in the street being hoes, a lot of these black females are here for the streets. And we have convinced ourselves by having Amber Rose say that sluts are okay. We've convinced ourselves to say that, I'm going to go through my hoe phase because hoe phase is important. Black women have destroyed themselves mentally. It's okay now that a black woman says, I don't want to be fit. I don't want to be cooperative. I don't want to be submissive. Those things are not the qualities of a real woman, because you have these activists that are not married telling you that in your marriage, keep your money away from your man. Keep your time away from your man. Keep your kids away from your man. There are so many things going on right now that are destroying the black family. And it's being passed down from generation to generation. There are moms out there that they were taught, they pass it on to their daughters, and their daughters are horrible wives. Their daughters are horrible mothers. Their daughters are horrible co-workers. Their daughters are horrible managers. Their daughters are horrible all around. They try. Yeah, we're going to give them the benefit of the doubt. They try. But then they always boomerang back to what mama instilled in them. Mama instilled in them, mama, he ain't shit. Girl, don't trust no man. Mama said it. Mama said to fight a man. Mama said to argue with a man. Mama said to be deceitful to a man. Mama said be sneaky to your man. Mama said always good to have you another man on the side. Mama said it. But mama, look at the mamas that are saying it right now. The mamas that are saying it right now, I guarantee you they wish they could. The mamas that have their daughters destroying their families and breaking apart their families because the mama didn't teach them forgiveness. The mama didn't teach them that there will be rocky roads. The mama didn't teach them that there will be rough times in marriage and relationships. They couldn't teach it because they weren't a part of it. They're both, most of the moms were single moms that did not get married. The men did not commit to them. Those same boys that we talked about that are 16 but 50 on the outside. Well, the same thing goes with the moms. The moms are 14, 13, 12 on the inside. Those little girls experience trauma at earlier ages than men. So we're going to go down on the age. So you have 48-year-old women that are 12 years old on the inside. And so that little 12-year-old girl that wanted mama's attention, that 12-year-old girl, and mama was at the club, mama was out sleeping with everybody's husband, mama was out sleeping with multiple men, mama had a putting miles on her, putting more and more miles on her every day, drunk, smoking, partying, right? Who raised you? But then we have to address it, because the only way to get through it, we have to admit that we have the problem in the community. How many women are 70, 60, 50, 80 years old? There's a few women out there that's 80, 90 years old that gives enlightenment and that will tell you the truth and that follow God's word and follow the word of God. Yes, but there are a majority of those women are partying with their children, out at the clubs with their children, drinking with their children, smoking with their children, doing all the other things with their children. But if you ask them, what moral values have you put into your child? What would they say? Nothing. And I feel so bad. Men, we cannot get upset. If you're married, this is to the married men. If you're married to a young lady that used to be a shadow chick, you're married to a woman that has been with multiple men, you're married to a woman that comes from a background of hurt, pain, destruction, right? And then you're a little boy yourself and you come from the same background and you guys decide to be together. You have to understand that shit's gonna be rough. You have to understand that shit's gonna be rough. It's not gonna be easy at all. Because you got two people that didn't get the help that they needed, right? You have two people that didn't get the help that they needed mentally as children. Then you have them coming together as a couple. And as they're coming together as a couple, they run into all these different problems because daddy didn't teach the man, mother didn't teach the daughter, and now they're attacking each other and they're downgrading each other and they're talking bad about each other and they're dividing their money and their times, and the woman don't want to be with the man because he ain't good with money, the man don't want to be with the woman because she ain't good with money, or neither one of them are good with money, and they're running into financial situations. And the key is you have blended families because some women have children before they get with their husbands, and some husbands have children before they get with their wives, and so then you bring all those children together, and then you start to give all that blended family and those children the same thing that you got when you were being raised. Can somebody help me? Tell me I'm not telling the truth. Delete me. Unsubscribe from me if you know that I'm not lying. In the black community, we have really been trash. Our morals, our values, the things that we were raised on were trash. What do we do? How do we move forward? We have women out here right now that are walking around. They're not proud of themselves anymore. They're walking around. I understand some women are fighting for this whole bonnet situation. But I remember a time when the elder spoke, the young listened. I remember a time when the elder spoke, the young listened. When grandmother opened her mouth, when someone over 55, 60 opened their mouth, you listened. Monique said, hey, don't wear bunnies, baby. You're beautiful. You never know when your opportunity may come. The person that may want to hire you and you're unemployed may be right there and strike up a conversation with you. Are you presentable enough to get the job? And black women drug her. Monique, you can't say nothing. You ain't got no bra on under your robe when you did the video. That's not the point. It's not the point. It's the point is telling the truth. Our younger said black women are out of line. We need to get them back in line. Black women need to close their legs and open their hearts. They drug our younger for that. Because there's no accountability in the community. There's no accountability with the men. And there's definitely no accountability with black women holding each other accountable because they feel like, I can help her all day long, but if she don't listen, well, no. You tell her, sit your ass down. You are not a good wife. You're not a good mother. Now that we've come to that conclusion and you understand that you're not a good wife or a good mother or a good friend or a good employee, now let's do the work. I'm not going to allow. When are we going to sit down as men and tell the men, I'm not going to allow you to leave your wife. I'm not going to allow you to cheat on your wife. When are the women going to sit down with the women and say, girl, I know you have problems with your man, but you're supposed to have problems. God did not promise you happiness. He promised you joy. Sometimes. Sit your ass. We need to have a sit your ass down session. Sit your ass down. Because when you tell them to sit their ass down, you get their attention. Sit your ass down and understand that you have work to do. You're a wife. You made the commitment. I won't allow you to leave a committed relationship. Now, under circumstance, if he's beating you and he's kicking you and he's dragging you down the hallway, yes, let's make some situations to help you get out of that physically abusive relationship. However, if he ain't beating your ass, then your ass needs to get to work. If she ain't beating your ass, then your ass needs to get to work. Men, women that are married, We're destroying the black family at an enormous rate. We're allowing the system to take fathers away from their children. We're allowing the divorce system to take husbands and wives away from their children. We're getting to the point that we're more invested in the father seeing the kid every weekend than being in a household to have game nights on Wednesday with the family being together. Some situations that we carry, some beef that we have in our marriages. I'm talking to the married people. Some situations that you have in your marriage are all based on a conversation that you refuse to have. You have women that say, "I don't want to have no conversation." You have men saying, "Man, fuck up." When is it going to get to a point where you understand that you are the problem? You're the problem because you have been injected with toxicity from your mom, from your dad, from your family, from generations of bull. When are we going to come to that conclusion to understand that? Black women have black men have a long way to go, but black women, like I said again, they have dealt with this from conception. Women are emotional, so the emotional dysfunction attaches to them way easier and quicker than it does to the men. Yes, we have 100 problems, but women have 1,000. They already have 2 strikes to get them. They're black, they're women. Right? And then you have men who have hurt women because that's all men know how to do. You have women who have hurt men because that's all they know how to do. Mama taught you that, but who raised you? I'm not asking you to attack your mom. I'm not asking you to attack your dad, but understand if they're stuck in their ways, you must change yours. If daddy beat the shit out of his kids, you don't need to beat the shit out of yours. If mama said the kids don't have a voice, you should, as a black woman, you should give your kids a voice. If your mama didn't nurture you, your mama didn't sit down and talk to you about sex and boys and girls and what happens and STDs and all this other stuff. How many moms just said, "Keep your drawers up"? How many daddies said, "Son"? It was a completely different scenario. I found myself in a situation with my son. I've seen my son look at women. I'm looking in the corner like, "Yeah, that's my boy." But am I really sitting down saying, "Son, you go with her, you be with her, you respect her, you love her, you adore her, you treat her with respect and honesty and dignity, and don't be a hoe. If you have issues, sit down and talk to her." Are we really saying that? Are we more proud of the fact that he wants the girl? Or are we going to add morals and values to that? We're guilty. I am guilty of that. Transparency is good for the soul. I will never sit on here and act like I'm a damn angel. And I've been the same way with my children. I look at my son, "Yeah, that's my boy." But what really? Right? And then understanding my daughters, understanding that I have 3 beautiful daughters, understanding that they are going to have boyfriends one day and I can't accept it. I'm challenged with that now. My oldest daughter is 18. My youngest daughter is 11. My middle daughter is 13. And they're starting to look a way that I know boys like. And I have to understand, if I'm going to be proud that my son is maturing to get to the girl, then I have to also give the same wisdom and knowledge to my daughter. Instead of saying, "Hey, no nigga gonna be talking to my daughter," and then the nigga got my daughter hemmed up behind the bleachers or in the room because I was not willing to accept the fact she's gonna like boys just like my son's gonna like girls. I'm struggling with this now. Struggling with disciplining the children. Struggling on the structure of how I discipline my children. Dwayne, I'm hearing it from the left corner, the right corner. Dwayne, you're doing too much. You're doing too much. You're pushing your kids away. You're doing too much. Okay, then how do I move forward? Do I argue with the people who see it? The Bible says when 2 or 3 say the same thing, then everything is in agreement. So then I have to get my shit together. The same thing for women. If your husband's telling you you are not a good mama, you are not a good woman right now, if your husband's telling you that, he's telling you that, if he's still with you and he's telling you that, then you need to respect the fact that he's telling you that instead of going out and cheating on you or doing something crazy. And even when it comes to that in relationships, when it comes to that, we must also learn. Damn bug in here or something. Yeah, here you go right there. Hold on. Yeah, he got that die. Where is he? Hold on, it's a bug flying around here somewhere. But anyway, that's either here. Hold on, y'all. I gotta kill him. Give me just a second. Hold on. Yeah, I had to get him out of here, y'all. He gone. I'm sorry about that pause in the video. He had to go. Woo! He was a big old bug, too. I don't know how he got in here. Anyway, back to what I was saying. All seriousness, guys. We as a culture, we have to get better. Right? We have to get better, right? We have women walking out on their families. We have men walking out on their families. We have women not willing to forgive and move forward. Men are going to make mistakes if they didn't have proper training. Right? Even at your job, if you don't have proper training, you can't do the job. You can't fulfill the job. Right? Come on, guys. Y'all got to stick with me here. We got to do the work. We can't be more proud of our children getting into manhood, getting into womanhood, and then we're not addressing what that looks like. I will take the lead on this. I have failed as a parent because of tradition. Because I love my mom. I love my dad. Right? Me and my dad didn't have the best relationship. We he's still alive, but he didn't. But we can work on that. However, I've had a lot of bad relationships. I had a lot of things happen because I'm learning on my own. I'm learning these things on my own. It wasn't like I sat down and had these conversations. Was taught how to be a man, right? I had uncles that was hoes, right? I had family members that was hoes. Right now, I got uncles that kids are still coming out of the woodwork 30 years later. Right? And so growing up, it was everybody was in on it, right? Mom, dad, sisters, cousins, everybody was in it. Girl, your boy, your son, I mean, he tearing them up, ain't he? Toxic. Right? But what do we do with our children right now? What how do we be better for our children? Right? Our black women, we need you. We need you to be nurturers. We need you to be the backbone of the man. You were created for such a thing as this. Black women, we don't need you fighting your man. We don't need you cussing your man out. We don't need you divorcing your man. We need you to support him. And we also need the men to support the black women. But back in the day, when a black man was down, his woman lifted him. When a black woman was down, the black man lifted her. If you're in a relationship and you're not married, you're single. But if you're married, you're married. And so I want to encourage all married couples today to love each other, to be with each other, to learn to find it. Because most people make the mistake of thinking that love is going to be the main thing in a marriage. It's not. Sometimes the loves wear down, and that's when you really are challenged in your self-control. You're really challenging the person who you really are, and it shows who you really are when you run into things and you run into problems and you run into situations. See, your character is not defined on what people can see, but your character is defined on what you do when no one's watching. So we have to get better as a culture. Who raised you? I need you to sit down and get a pen and paper and start journaling, right? I need you to get pen and paper and write down how many traditional roles am I influencing in my life right now that came from my mom and my dad, and they didn't know no better, and those morals and those things that they taught me were trash. Can we admit it? Can we say, mom and daddy, what they did was trash? And stop making an excuse for them that say, oh, they did the best they could. Sleeping with all these men, that's not the best you could. That's the 16-year-old girl on the inside of your mama that's saying, I need attention. I want a man. I want to be loved. I want to be cared for. And she didn't get it. And so when she didn't get it for one, she moved to the next and thought he was the one. And then the next, and the next, and the next, and the next, and the next. And then after that, you got so many miles on your car, it won't start. How many women out there right now are married and they're seeking divorce? Men that are out there right now married, seeking divorce, all based off the fact that you won't change your mindset because of what mama taught you or what daddy taught you. And then you go look at your mom and she's single and miserable. Not even blaming your mom because your mom didn't get the treatment. She didn't get the help. And so she didn't, mentally, she was not attractive
to someone who could have loved her unconditionally. The father was not, his mind was not attractive because of something he didn't get help for when he was younger, he was a child. And so, in the words of Kevin Samuels, buy a dog, buy a cat, you're gonna die alone. That is harsh, right? But it's the God's honest truth. If you don't make the necessary changes, you will end up in divorce and die alone. If you don't make the necessary changes, you will wake up every morning to pillows and not people. Your children will resent you. Your husband will leave you. Your wife will leave you. We need, in our community, we need to sit down and have conversations. We need to have circle. Listen to me. Listen to me. Women, you, if single, married, engaged, you need to have a circle of positive women. You don't need to have a circle of women that want to go sit down at Red Lobster and talk about niggas ain't shit. You need to get around some women that says, girl, I've had the same problem. How can I help you with your marriage? What can I do to help you with your husband and your family? What can me and my husband do to assist you in that? And then have that circle be so tight that you can share with these people, that you can share the love and the affection with these people, and the hurt and the pain that you've experienced, and infidelity, and outside children, and blended families. Blended families is the number one breaker of families. God damn it. I could, that is the truth. I'm telling you from experience. However, we have to get better. Black men, I'm not going to sit here and say, step up, be a man. Oh, how can you tell somebody to step up and be something that they've never seen, that they've never experienced? Some of these men, like myself, some of us have to learn on the fly. Right? I can't go back to the teachings of the past because my daddy has a little boy in him that was not healed. My grandfather, which I love so much, has a little boy in him that was not healed. And he went through a lot because he grew up in the 30s and the 40s, right? I have the little boy in me that is not healed, that seems to sometimes want control, seems to sometimes want to control the narrative. But there's other people, but you have to be open to other people's opinions and other people's feelings, right? I struggle with that. So I want to be able to be transparent with you guys. I want my life to be an open book to you guys to understand that we can do this together as people. Right? Let's share the knowledge. But the most important thing is to have a circle. Ladies, you need to have that circle that you can go out with once a month, and you encourage each other's marriages, and you uplift each other's marriages, and you talk about the books you've read to help your marriage, and you talk about the things you've done to help your marriage, and you talk about how you spice back up your sex life in your marriage, you talk about how you forgave your husband for infidelity, and how you can move forward from that, because people make mistakes, women make mistakes, men make mistakes. How can your marriage recover? Get you a circle that speaks life into the very existence of what it is that you are experiencing. Men, same thing. We don't do it. Men need to get together. What, if you got a family, you got kids, you got a wife, get together once a month with the fellas. Kick back and talk about, hey, man, I committed this sin. I committed this infidelity. The women, you can do the same. I committed this infidelity. The men, get together and say, hey, listen, how do I get through this? How do I go through the process of healing with my spouse? How do I go through the process of children that I've hurt in the past? How do I go through the process of not boomeranging back to what I used to be? Because some of us wake up with change, and then by the end of the day, we're back to who we are, because it's a process. And then lastly, if we're spiritual, we pray about it. We pray about it, but we act about it, right? We pray about it. We act about it, right? Because it's okay not to be okay. That's why the circle is important, but we act about it. If I make a commitment, I need to get with my circle and say, I've committed to be a better father to my estranged children. I've chosen to be a better husband to my wife. I've gone to ask my wife for forgiveness, my children for forgiveness, my coworkers for forgiveness, the people that I've hurt in the past for forgiveness, and your circle is there to support you. And when you fail, you can go take your failures to your circle, and your circle can tell you, get your ass up. the women can tell the women, get your ass up. You're not leaving your husband because of a technicality. Husbands, get your ass up. You're not going to leave your wife for a technicality. You're not going to put your hands on your husband. You're not going to put your hands on your wife. You're going to do this. This is what we can do. Matter of fact, how about all of us get together and have a round table discussion on how we can help your marriage grow, how we can plant seeds of love and reverence and love and understanding back into your family, back into your family life with your children, back into your marriage, back into your personal life. Whether you're single, engaged, or married, you need to have a circle of encouragement. You need to have a circle that's going to steer you in the right direction and not tell you what you want to hear, but tell your ass what you need to hear. Because if you got a friend that's telling you, girl, you need to get rid of his ass, get rid of her. Right? You need a friend that's going to tell you what you need to hear. Girl, listen, you married this man. You made a commitment to this man. That's your husband. If he ain't beating your ass, then I need you to get on your shit, and we're going to help you find a way to reach him, and my husband's going to help him find a way to reach you, and we're going to make this thing work. And then years later, when that next couple in your group is going through the same thing, your testimony is that seed that you planted, and now it has blossomed to something beautiful, and now that testimony has grown from those seeds that were planted by the other couple that helped you. Now they can see the flower in your relationship, and you're able to help someone else. Who raised you guys? Generational curses passed down from generation to generation. I'm asking you guys, who raised you? And it's not going to be easy, guys, for the married couples. It's not going to be easy for the individuals. It's not going to be easy cutting off the experiences and the trauma from your mama trauma, daddy trauma. Right? It's not going to be easy, but somebody's got to do it. Let's start today. You and I, let's start today. Right? I still struggle with some things that I learned in the past that I try to inflict on my children, on my relationships, on my anything that I get hold of into. Right? I'm not going to say men step up, get on your shit. I'm saying men, let's get a circle of us together and encourage each other to become the very men that we did not see, that we did not learn from. And black women, I'm asking for your understanding, that you understand that your man is not the man he needs to be, because there's not a man that helped him be the man that you want him to be. Women, same thing. Men, let's be patient for a season and allow our women to prosper and to grow into who the woman that God created them to be. However, we don't want our women to be stagnant. We want our women to be able to get in a circle of God-fearing women. I call them AWOGs, amazing women of God. Get them in a circle of AWOGs and let those AWOGs be able to encourage them to come home and love you. Come home and be with the children. Show them how to be patient with the children. Show the men how to be patient with their daughters, patient with their sons, patient at their job, patient with their wives. It's a collective bargaining agreement. This has been Black Men Unfiltered. See you guys tomorrow.